Hey, welcome to part 3 of my series on FFT analyzers. Parts 1 and 2 give a basic function overview and an introduction to measurement system anatomy. Go check those out first if you haven't seen them already. In part 3, I'm going to be explaining how an analyzer converts an audio signal into a graph of level over frequency when doing spectrum measurements. It does this using something called an FFT, or Fast Fourier Transform. Spectrum measurements involve sending one audio signal into an analyzer, which then shows us information about the frequency content of that signal at a given instant. The thing about that is, sound doesn't actually exist in an instant. Audio signals are a function of time, so without time passing, sound doesn't exist. This means that when we use an analyzer to look at measurements in real time, it's actually chopping time into chunks that we call time windows, and then it's showing us measurements of these time windows many times per second. That pretty effectively gives us the illusion of continuous real-time measurement. The way that the analyzer converts the audio signal into a graph of level over frequency is by performing something called a Fast Fourier Transform, or FFT, which is basically the name of some fancy math. We don't actually have to know how the math behind a Fourier transform works, but there are some important things we need to be aware of to use it. When we use an FFT analyzer, we feed an audio signal into an analog to digital converter, and then we feed the digitally sampled audio signal into the analyzer. We'll refer to the signal as the sampled waveform. Like I said, sound doesn't exist in an instant, so the analyzer looks at the sampled waveform in chunks, which we call time windows, and the length of each time window is called the time constant. If the waveform is sampled at a rate of 48,000 times per second, or 48,000 hertz, we can multiply that sample rate by the time constant to find the total number of samples that fall within a time window. When we use an FFT analyzer, we have to decide how long the time constant should be. Because the time constant is directly proportional to the number of samples that are in the time window, we can specify its length either by the length of time of the time constant or just by the number of samples that fall within it. Sometimes when we specify that parameter, it's just referred to as FFT size. So to recap, the part of the sampled waveform that's being measured is limited to a time window, and we choose its length or time constant based on how many samples are in it. When we do this, the analyzer will only give us a limited number of options for time constant. I won't get into the reasons for why there are limited options now, but the number of samples in the time window has to be a power of 2. So for example, it could be any of the following. Imagine that we choose 128 samples as our FFT size. If we divide 128 by the sample rate of 48 kHz, we'll get 1 over 375. That means the time constant is 1/375th of a second, which is 2 2/3 milliseconds. The inverse of the time constant, or 1 divided by the time constant, will give us the lowest frequency that we're able to measure, because it's the frequency that completes one full cycle within the time window. So if our time constant is 1/375th of a second, that means the lowest frequency we're able to measure is 375 hertz. From there, we can then measure multiples of 375 hertz. The number of samples that we feed into the FFT will be equivalent to the number of frequency data points that the FFT gives us back. So in this case, the FFT will give us information about 128 different frequencies, ranging from 375 up to 128 times 375, which happens to be 48,000, which is our sample rate. However, only half of that data is useful to us because half of that data is above the Nyquist frequency. The Nyquist frequency is half of our sample rate, and data about frequencies above the Nyquist frequency is not usable. Therefore, when we put in 128 samples, we get back 64 usable frequency data points, ranging from 375 hertz to 24,000 hertz. In this image, we can compare data about the same source signal but using different time constants. The top one uses 128 samples like in the example. Remember, our frequency data points are spaced out in increments of 375 hertz. Because the increments are linear, but we're viewing this data on a logarithmic frequency scale, there's a greater level of detail in the high frequency data. This is true for all other FFT sizes shown. You'll notice that the 32,000 sample FFT has good details at low frequencies, but more data than we actually need at high frequencies. Conversely, the 128 sample FFT has a reasonable amount of detail in the high frequencies, but not nearly enough in the low frequencies. Without data below 375 Hz, this actually wouldn't be useful to us for a range of applications. Now that we know a little more about FFTs, time windows, and time constants, we can look at ways to manipulate all this data so that it becomes useful to us. In the next part of this series, I'll talk about how and why we use averaging and banding when we look at spectrum measurement data. If you're planning to stick around and watch the next video, please hit subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.